what a tangled web we weave when we practice to deceive. Yes, and of course, deception is an art. It's an art form which, of course, must be perfected by people like politicians, generals, diplomats, and, of course, above all, spies. Deception, of course, is the stock in trade of spies the world over, and, of course, it is also the stock in trade of our own British intelligence service, MI5, MI6, and all the rest of it. The problem is, of course, that a good lie must approximate, to some extent at least, to the truth. A bad lie is one where you can be easily found out, as the British government discovered to its cost over the events of the last few days. Of course, you're asking for trouble, aren't you? You're asking for trouble if you're going to appoint a circus clown like Boris Johnson to be the Foreign Secretary of any sovereign state. And of course, you pay a price for that. Boris Johnson couldn't wait. The fellow possibly fell over himself, literally fell over himself, before he stampeded before the House of Commons, announcing to the entire world that, of course, this terrible attempted murder of Skripal and his daughter in Salisbury was undoubtedly the work of Russia. Surprise, surprise. You realise that everything nowadays is down to Russia. Even the weather is down to Russia. The beast from the east, quote unquote. Here, this man has the brazen audacity to appear before the House of Commons, announcing as a matter of absolutely firm fact something which is not a fact at all. And of course, subsequently, the arguments put forward had to be backed by what? Well, by science, of course. Who can argue with science? And therefore, of course, the argument put forward by scientists from allegedly put forward by Portland Down, of course, this has the stamp of authenticity, of truth, of scientific truth written all over it. In the last few days, our dear foreign minister, yet again, in an interview in Germany, made the statement that he was categorically assured by these scientists. But of course, this Novichok stuff was undoubtedly administered by Russians, was made, manufactured, produced, distributed, and employed by the Russians for the devious purposes of assassination. QED, one would have thought. Well, not so. Because within a matter of days, a spokesman, an official spokesman, from the very same scientific community at Portland Down, clarified that at no time had they ever stated that this noxious substance came from Russia or any other source. They pointed out quite clearly and in very scientific and very objective and calm language that their remit was not that at all. All that they were trying to do, evidently with some success, was to establish the nature of the agent, the toxic agent produced in this assassination attempt. They came to the conclusion that it belonged to the Novichok family. Not exactly Novichok, but not quite Novichok, but something similar to Novichok, something from the Novichok family. Full stop. End of story. At no point did they say, or could they say, where it came from. Might have been Russia, might have been the Ukraine, might have been somewhere else. Who knows? Who can say? Nobody can say. There's no evidence whatsoever, my friends, not a shred of evidence, not the slightest teeny millimetre of evidence which could establish a relationship between this noxious substance and the mysterious origin in Russia itself. So Boris, my friend, caught out once again, because this isn't the first time. He's got form, this man, telling lies. He lied through his teeth at the time of the Brexit campaign, quite blatantly, alleging that so many hundreds of millions of pounds were going to be dedicated to the British National Health Service once Britain would withdraw from the European Union. That has been exploded as a lie, a conscious, deliberate, palpable, blatant lie, which this man repeated and repeated and continues with all the brazen-faced effrontery in the world to repeat to anyone that cares to listen to him. He told other lies also, which have recently been exploded on the BBC. This man tells lies, manufactures lies like a an efficient sausage-making machine. 1 a minute, if you like. And now he's been caught out. And with him, the British government has been caught out. And the intelligence, if that word is apposite, which I have some doubts about, the intelligence community have also been caught out. They've had to withdraw. Shamefacedly, yesterday, they had to delete a tweet in which they made this ridiculous assertion that it's from Russia. Of course, the Russians have taken advantage, naturally, to persist in their insistence that they were not responsible for this. And incidentally, as I've said on previous occasions, there is no earthly proof. Incidentally, there is no motive for them to have done such a thing. As I've explained, I won't repeat the arguments. There's no possible motive. And whenever the question of a motive for Putin and the Russians is raised, they always run a mile. There is no motive, no possible motive. No possible benefit could accrue to Putin or the Russians for doing any such a thing. Therefore, the government of Her Majesty in the United Kingdom is on the back foot, is in serious difficulties. Boris Johnson, really speaking, should resign as Foreign Secretary after lying to Parliament, which of course is not considered to be acceptable. The government, in any case, was in a weak position, which is precisely why they've engaged in this stupid game of attacking the Russians, in order to distract attention from the internal dissensions, the splits over Brexit, their general extreme weakness. This is a weak government. It's a government that was against the ropes. It's a prime minister that is fit for nothing. Even The Economist recently carried an editorial saying that she was, what was the expression? Unacceptable, intolerable, but unsackable. Unsackable because the replacement possibilities are even worse. Yes, and under these circumstances, the Labour Party should have been on the offensive. It should have gone for the jugular. It should have been attacking this government by every possible means at its disposal. If that's not been the case, it's not because they couldn't do so. It's because of consistent and blatant sabotage being perpetrated day in, day out by the usual culprits, the right wing of the Parliamentary Labour Party. That's the majority, of course, of the Parliamentary Labour Party. These ladies and gentlemen, these Blairites, this Blairite fifth column, because that's what a Tory fifth column within the Labour Party, that's what they are, nothing else, fell silent. They fell silent. After months and months of vicious, aggressive, brutal attacks against the Labour leader, Jeremy Corbyn, they had to shut up after the general election result became clear, which was a stunning victory for Jeremy Corbyn and the left and the socialist elements of the Labour Party, and of course a stunning defeat, therefore, for the manoeuvres and the intrigues and the conspiracies of the right wing, which only have one agenda. It's not to get rid of the Tories. It's not to get rid of Boris Johnson. It's not to get rid of Theresa May. It's to get rid of Jeremy Corbyn. And of course, now they've resumed the attack. They've resumed the attack in the most disgusting way. Incidentally, on this issue, where Jeremy Corbyn was quite right, and he's been shown to be correct in attacking and criticising the government's haste in attacking Russia without the slightest proof, he was heckled and interrupted by these scoundrels on the Labour benches. Absolute blatant sabotage of the worst sort. Yes, but not only that. They've now resorted to an even dirtier method, which is absolutely a scandal if you come to think about it. Accusing Jeremy Corbyn, of all people, a man who's devoted his life to the struggle against racism, of being what? Of being a racist. Oh, yes. Of being an anti-Semite, if you please. The Labour Party now, it is said, and it's repeated and repeated in the press, on the television, on the radio, not an accident, fed constantly by these Blairite creatures, the Labour Party is supposed to be rife with anti-Semitism. Now, what anti-Semitism are they referring to? Of course, anti-Semitism, Jeremy Corbyn said quite rightly, is a terrible thing, it's a poisonous thing, which, of course, no socialist, no internationalist, nobody like Jeremy Corbyn could possibly tolerate anything like anti-Semitism. And yet, of course, he is accused of this. For what reason? Well, you know, it's really is something. Right-wing Jewish organizations, that's what they are. Reactionary Jewish organizations, nothing in common with the Labour Party whatsoever, have organized this disgraceful campaign in cahoots with the Blairites, with these gangsters still sitting on the Labour benches, I hope not for long. They've organized this scare campaign, this smear campaign, and it consists of the following, if you think about it. You see, there's two separate things here. One is the question of one's attitude towards Jewish people, who would deserve the same respect as any other person, irrespective of their race, their color, their sex, their religion, or anything else. We stand for complete equality. We're opposed to any form of racism. Yes, that's one thing. And the state of Israel, which is a different thing altogether. I'm very sorry about it. They try to confuse the two. Look at the conduct of this reactionary, aggressive, imperialist state in the Middle East, which has systematically oppressed other people. They talk about the oppression of the Jews, which was a terrible thing in the past. What about the oppression of the Palestinians by the Israeli state? Not by Jews, by this reactionary gang, which is the Israeli Zionist state. To oppose that, my friends, is not anti-Semitism in any sense, shape or form. It's anti-imperialism, and it's a defense of an oppressed people, which of course in this case is the Palestinians. Now, to confuse these two things is the most vicious, the most cynical, the most appalling stunt that you could possibly imagine. And that's the game that they're at. Anyone that criticizes the state of Israel, which only in the recent days has been shooting and killing and wounding unarmed demonstrators protesting against the actions of the Israeli state. Yes, that's okay. Anyone that criticizes that is automatically tarred with the brush of anti-Semitism. Well, I'm very sorry, my friends. We don't buy this. I don't buy this. No sensible, intelligent person buys this. No sensible, intelligent Jewish person or member of the Labour Party buys this. Everyone is well aware that what is behind this is not a question of the defense of the Jewish people or any other people. It is a part of the same dirty, unprincipled, lying, slanderous campaign aimed at the idea of eliminating Jeremy Corbyn before he gets too close to number 10 Downing Street. That's the fact. Finally, well, what is to be done about this? I think something's going to be done about it. Something's going to be done by it. By the members of the Labour Party. You know the words of Shelley's poem, which the Labour leader quoted to Glastonbury. Yes, we are many, they are few. So few that a tiny handful, these gangsters in the parliamentary Labour Party. How long, my friends, are we going to allow this disgraceful state affairs to continue? It really has proceeded for far too long. These people, the Kinnocks and the other elements involved in this, should really be shown the door, you know. They're on about ejecting anti-Semites from the Labour Party. If there are anti-Semites in the Labour Party, of course, they ought to be ejected. But above all, the people that we should be talking about ejecting, and in the near future, are these. The Labour fifth column, the Tory fifth column, which has hijacked the parliamentary Labour Party and is hell-bent on destroying Jeremy Corbyn, and in the process, of course, if they can get away with it, of destroying the Labour Party also. No, my friends. Look, enough is enough. Let us put at the top of the agenda of the order of the day a national campaign to eject from the Labour Party, not just anti-Semites, of course, that goes without saying. Let's also eject the anti-Labourites, which are now sitting and howling and like a pack of hounds, hungry hounds, on the benches of the parliamentary Labour Party. No, enough is enough. Let's take a big broom and through the process of deselection, carry through the democratic rights that we have in order to purge the Labour Party of this cancer, which frankly is a disgrace which should never be allowed to exist.